We're very pleased to introduce to the blog today Dr. Erdem Huner. He's a physiotherapist, he's a researcher, an instructor, he's a business owner, but most importantly, he's a thought leader. He practices out of his clinic, which is York Physiotherapy Associates in Richmond Hill, Ontario, here in Canada. Erdem holds a Doctor of Science degree in physical therapy from Andrews University and the Diploma of Advanced Orthopedic Manual and Manipulative Physiotherapy from the Canadian Physiotherapy Association. He is a fellow of the Canadian Academy of Manipulative Physiotherapy. But Erdem is much more than a regular physiotherapist. His doctoral research on the use of dry needling for the treatment of muscle pain and dysfunction put him in a position to co-author a clinical manual on this topic and to instruct, along with a select group of Canada's top physiotherapists, a course for professionals on the clinical use of dry needling. He teaches in the Canadian Physiotherapy Association's Postgraduate Orthopedic Physiotherapy Program of Study. He's a mentor for physiotherapists enrolled in the same program and the related examination processes. Erdem is a leader in the world of physical therapy and rehabilitation, with his clients obviously, but also amongst professionals, and I'm honored that he's agreed to join me here today for a discussion on his work and its context in the world. So thank you. Thank you very much for being here, Dr. Huner.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Total pleasure. So I'm going to get us going with a quick and dirty question, an important question for the general audience, and that is, in one sentence, what do you think is the most important thing that a person can do for their own health?
Well, that's pretty hard in one sentence, but I would say move often.
Yeah.
Eat well and sleep enough.
Okay. I love it. Basic health habits, right? I like that. The eat or the move often. I would even say move beautifully and often. The sleeping is something that I don't think gets appreciated enough. And I put that in there with sort of a basket of fundamental health habits along with, what was this, the third one that you said? The sleep well, the move often, and what was the other one?
Eat well.
Yeah. That's a great one. And then I would also add in, have a great social network of people who you value and admire.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And then some sort of reflective practice. Some people choose meditation, could be deep reading, journaling, something that gets you thinking about what you're doing in life and if you're on track in sort of alignment with the goals that you have for yourself. So I love those three in that, and I definitely a page from my own book as well. That's a good answer. I like that a lot. So how about us as clinicians? What can we do as clinicians to best assist people, our clients, and just the people around us towards this type of end?
Well, obviously, I mean, as physiotherapists, I don't profess to be an expert, for example, in nutrition or sleep hygiene. Definitely, I think we should consider ourselves to be, you know, at least self-professed experts in movement.
Yeah.
So that's one area, the movement side of things. I will, you know, definitely provide a lot of education, demonstrate how to do that, give a very construct plan. But as clinicians, I think that our concern should also be the overall health of our patient and that everything is integrated. I mean, you cannot, you know, optimize one area of your health and not others. So I think our role is to provide education on the importance of these other areas, such as sleeping. I mean, there's so much research, for example, in the field that we work in with movement dysfunction and especially, you know, persistent pain states, that there's so much research that shows that poor sleep can contribute to that.
Yeah.
So that's something where we're going to just give some basic advice on highlighting to our patients and our clients that this is an area that they should look into, maybe inquire into how it's going. And if we think that they could use extra help in this area, that to direct them to the right people and sometimes the right resources. I mean, we really have to work in a multidisciplinary manner with the other people who are experts in those areas. And the same thing when it comes to nutrition. I don't myself give nutritional advice per se, but I definitely encourage people to look into it and direct them to somebody who can help when I think it is it would be beneficial to them.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty good answer. I would agree with that. I think this whole idea of being multidisciplinary is important, but I think that part of that package involves a responsibility on our part as clinicians to have a quality network of people that we know, trust, and whose work we view to be good, because when we send someone to another clinician, it really is a reflection of our own work. And I think that that is an underappreciated aspect of what it means to be a multidisciplinary clinician.
And the other thing I would say is to always try to role model. I mean, it's hard to say to somebody, I think you need to get a certain amount of exercise per week. I think you need to be doing these types of things. And then when they ask you, well, what do you do?
Yeah.
You know, if you say, well, I don't do anything.
Yes.
Or it doesn't reflect very well. And
yes.
We all have different issues with our health. We fall off the wagon from time to time. I mean, I myself have gained weight, lost weight, been more active, less active in my life, had injuries, surgeries that prevented me from being as active as I wanted to. But it was always striving to do the most that I can at any given point in my life. That was always my goal, and that's what I demonstrate to patients, is that there's always opportunity to do enough, and there's always opportunity to do even more than you're currently doing as well.
Yeah. Yeah, I could not agree more. Role modeling, lead first by example. Right? It counts with our clients, and it counts with everyone else around us as well. We have to lead first by example. Fundamental professional responsibilities. Love it.
That's right.
Okay, good. So thanks for that. Let's talk about your research a little bit. You have done some research in an area that I find I have a particular interest in right now, and that is dry needling. But I'll let you sort of speak to that a little bit more. Can you tell us briefly about your doctoral research?
So the main body of research that I conducted, my main study, was particularly looking at the role of dry needling on, we'll say, strength, or the ability of a muscle to contract, which is, I'd say, not one of the main areas of focus of dry needling. So,
yeah.
So often people will look at, you know, the effect on pain, the effect on function, the effect on tenderness, all these things that trigger points are associated with. But my research specifically looked at, okay, so if somebody, you know, to make it really simple, if you were to, you know, dry needle or poke a needle into somebody's muscle, then what would the immediate effects be on the ability of that muscle to contract? So, you know, you can have ways to measure this using a digital device that I employed. And I specifically looked at one area of the body. In research, sometimes we have to kind of really hone in on certain things to make it, you know, something that you can study. So I specifically looked at the glutes,
yep.
Which is a major area of focus and a major area of what some people think is dysfunction in many people. Sometimes maybe it's thought to be more dysfunctional. You know, I don't like to use that word, dysfunctional, but more involved than it is necessarily, but it's definitely an area of focus. And I just noticed in my own patients that often after dry needling, especially if there was a certain response, which is a twitch in the muscle, which is something that we seek when we dry needle a muscle. And I noticed that if there was a twitch in particular, that there was a sudden change in the ability of that muscle to just produce a maximum contraction.
Huh.
Doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to feel better by doing that, or that it's going to change anything per se, but it was an interesting clinical tidbit for me. And
how on earth, if you don't mind my interjection, how on earth did you happen to notice that? Like, in what context were you needling someone and then looking at their maximum contraction?
Okay, so, well, you know, when we assess somebody, I mean, you never, as physiotherapists and as any physiotherapist who strives to be the best they can be, you never assess somebody with this thought that I am going to be performing a specific type of treatment on them from the beginning. You assess them, you take in their history, everything you can by just asking questions. Then you start to look at how they move. You do a bunch of orthopedic tests and assessments, and along the way you pick up certain things. And then in some people, as physiotherapists, hopefully we pick up, you know, at times that people are weak,
right,
in certain areas, or at least that they appear to be weak. That may be pain that's stopping from contracting, but often they just don't seem to contract certain muscles very well.
Mm-hmm.
We have certain tests for that. So in some of those people, as, you know, out of clinical curiosity, after I would dry needle that particular muscle or that region of the body, I would not just look at, okay, you know, doing a test to see if there was still pain or poking on that muscle, but I'd often repeat that test looking at their strength. And sometimes I'd see, wow, you know, there's a sudden improvement. And often we, you know, as physiotherapists, we know, and, you know, many people that work in the area of physical and manual medicine know that, you know, strength is not just about, you know, how big your muscle is and how juiced up it is, and that you have to work out for 3 months in order to gain a lot of strength. We know that that is the true definition of strength, but there's also something called recruitment, or activation is a popular word that's thrown around these days. So we know that there's a bit of a switch.
Yeah.
So a muscle can kind of just suddenly switch on, and it's probably more a result of you know, the connection of the software and the hardware and using everything you already have. And it was clear to me that that was probably what was going on. So I decided to say, okay, is this something that I'm biased to maybe thinking of seeing, you know, when you get a patient to, you know, contract, maybe it's just placebo effect, for example.
Yeah.
So I said, I need to research this and I need to use some sort of, you know, control or a placebo. So then I started to go down that route. And because there was no real research in this particular area at the time, what I started to do is just take what, you know, we would call a quote unquote normal population.
Right.
You know, I don't think any of us are particularly normal, but people who weren't really experiencing any significant pain or injury or dysphoria or problems in the area, just to see that if there was going to be an effect, you know, in a further line of research, I'd want to know, is this just a party trick and you just, you know, stimulate any muscle and get more out of it? Or is this something that is only happening to people with problems? So I started there, mm-hmm. and what I found was kind of what I had theorized, was that if you just insert a needle into a muscle and you don't get any particular response out of it, if you don't get a specific twitch, then there really is no change in the strength of the muscle immediately after. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. in the people that did get that twitch, what happened was that there was a definite, at least there was a statistical change in their strength. It was a significant change versus the people who weren't getting the twitch.
Okay.
Which might lead us to think actually that some of those people in fact were not, you know, they had at least what we would call a latent trigger point, which is an area in the muscle that's not really causing pain, but there's something going on there that's not quite the norm compared to other areas in the muscle. And we're probably just inadvertently accessing that point.
Okay. And so basically after, you know, doing these needling techniques and inducing this twitch response, which is a spinal reflex, if I'm not mistaken, is that correct?
I don't know if we're quite at the point where it called a spinal reflex, but we'll say it's a reflex that's mediated,
yeah,
or controlled at the spinal level. It's something that involves an intact wiring loop between,
sure,
the spine and,
okay,
the muscle. And it's not something that is just isolated in a muscle. I mean, if you had a completely anesthetized or paralyzed muscle, a spinal cord that was injured, you might not see this,
right,
response. So you're right. It is something that is more than just the muscle. It involves the nervous system globally. Yeah.
Okay, so we're inducing some kind of nervous system change that your results showed gave the patient an opportunity to show an improved maximal voluntary contraction. And you were suggesting there that you had some interest in determining whether or not this was a response that was seen in people that had some kind of pathology, or was it also something that could be induced in people who didn't have some kind of pathology, so just an athletic population, for example. And what did you find there? Was it something that was limited only to a pathological population, or could, you know, I do this if I wanted to get a better squat in the gym? You know, like needle my glutes a little bit and then hit the squat rack. Could happen.
Yeah, is it performance enhancing, I guess,
yes,
is the question.
Yeah, that's the question, yeah.
So, I mean, you really don't know, based on the research that I did, you really,
okay,
don't know until you go into the muscle and somebody who doesn't have a problem. And if you can elicit a twitch,
yeah,
then you can say that, oh, yeah, you're likely to get some improved strength. Now, I wouldn't quite go as far as jumping in to say that that's necessarily going to translate into something like a better squat or a more complex motion pattern. That's actually something I want to go on to research a little bit later on.
Right.
And also maybe to identify some of the, what we call the prognostic indicators or little indicators that perhaps this person would respond to it better than some other people. So we often say that the twitch response, the ability of that muscle to get this little isolated twitch with the stimulus, is something that is, you know, that only happens in the presence of trigger points. So one would say that, okay, well, if you have trigger points,
yeah,
if you could, you know, reliably identify these, that you would be somebody who would respond to it.
Yeah.
But we know that everybody has,
right,
trigger points. Trigger points, you know, everybody has at any given point in time lots of things going on. They've,
yeah,
got discs that may be quote-unquote degenerating,
yeah,
tendons that may be wearing down, muscles that have these identifiable trigger points that we can now identify through more objective means like imaging and ultrasound, not to say that they're causing pain, but just to identify that they do exist, because in the past there has been some controversy that we were just imagining this and we had invented them as clinicians.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you could identify them, and especially if they were causing pain, I would say clinically that you're more likely to see a response. But we don't know yet. This would be a future line of research on how long that effect will last. Is this just something that's going to have an immediate effect? It'll last for 4 or 5, 10 minutes. My study was the immediate effects within the following minutes of that that stimulus, the needle being inserted into the muscle. So we'll know, but I do know some clinicians who will use this, let's say, in the sporting world immediately before competition.
Interesting. People are going down that road already ahead of the science.
People are already going down that road, and they were going down that road before I'd studied it.
Okay.
One of the things that I wanted to know is that, is this something, for example, in our athletes pre-event, not that I always, there's a lot of reasons why you would decide to dry needle or not to needle somebody before an event, not just related to this.
Yeah.
You really have to know a little bit about their response. But one of the things was, is this going to improve their muscular response in some ways, or is it going to inhibit it and make it, the muscle so relaxed? That's what people say often, that, you shouldn't do a lot of exercise because the muscle will be so relaxed that you won't be stable. Based on what I've seen, I would say perhaps the opposite. Perhaps the muscle is more awakened, more alive. Your nervous system is a little more, primed, or what we would say upregulated.
Yeah.
So I don't think you're going to be, it's not going to be detrimental. You might not want to go hard on the weights, for example, because after inserting a needle into a muscle, there's going to be a little bit of internal tissue damage and bleeding. And we don't know if that might make the person very sore after pounding a bunch of squats after getting a needle into their glutes.
Okay. And just for the benefit of our audience, a trigger point is a band of localized contracted muscle fibers with a nodule at the middle. So some people might not be aware of that. So just to clarify that as well. Is that how you would describe it?
It's basically a very localized, what some people would often describe themselves as knots. They'd say, I have knots in my muscle. And for the most part, that's consistent with what we're seeing. There are little areas of focal contraction within a tight area of a muscle. It's not like the whole muscle is in spasm. It's a specific part in the muscle. And without going into detail, there's different things that happen there that explain that. Some electrical, chemical things that are going on. That's another talk.
Featuring many words with a lot of syllables. Yes, that's right.
That's right.
Okay, great. So, you're doing all this research work. You're also a clinician, an active clinician. You see patients on a daily basis. Are you a physiotherapist, or are you a scientist, or are you both? How would you describe what you do?
Oh, well, I'm first and foremost primarily a physiotherapist. I don't think of myself as a I have an inquisitive scientific mind, but I've dabbled in research. I dabble in the area of clinical research, so a researcher who has, through training and a little bit of experience, nothing too great, an experience in research. And I think that that's a huge area of importance, that we can't just have researchers and we can't just have clinicians. We can have those, but we also need somewhere in the middle a certain portion of our profession, or any healthcare profession, of people who are living in the clinical world but can also cross over a little bit into the research world, and likewise people who are primarily in the research world who cross over into the clinical world. So I am first and foremost a physiotherapist. I am a clinician. I don't, compared to some of the great scientists and researchers out there, I would not be considered to be in that group of somebody who lives primarily in that scientific research world. So I'm definitely a clinician, and 95% clinician.
Okay. So, don't sell yourself short, first of all. Maybe you're not in the same pages as Newton, but you're certainly producing research, which is more than many clinicians do. And I'm glad that you went into how valuable that is. And my next question was actually going to be, why do you think it is important for clinicians to participate in research? Why is that crossover important? Just, in 5 sentences or less.
Well, I think that, we as clinicians, we're on the front line. So we're seeing, what happens in patients. Our purpose is to serve people and to improve their health. And if we're just going to sit around and wait for people in these unknown laboratories to tell us what we should be doing, that's never going to happen. So I think as clinicians, we need to be agents of change.
Yeah.
We need to be the ones who innovate in many ways,
yeah.
provide innovations. And then if we're not going to be directly involved in research, we at least have to have established networks where we can go to the researchers and say, hey, you know, this is what we're seeing. This is what we think is happening. Is there any interest in taking this on
yeah.
as a research topic? And how can we help?
Yes.
That's basically, I think, where every clinician should be.
I completely agree with you. I think that the value that a clinician first professional can add to that scientific process is the questions present themselves first to us in that clinical setting. We see where the questions are, and as you were saying, you know, people are already, the practice is always a step ahead of the science, and in that we're trying things that may or may not be effective. We think they are, right? We use our best clinical judgment, our clinical expertise, to provide a treatment that we think has a rationale informed by the science, but not necessarily completely backed up by it yet. And yet those questions can be taken to either the researchers or posed by ourselves, and some of the, we can do some of that work ourselves as well, as you've done. So I think that you're setting a great example there. Once again, leading by example on that front. What do you think?
And if I may say,
go ahead.
And I would say that, you know, in medicine and broadly, in healthcare broadly, not just in physiotherapy, there's this concept of evidence-based medicine.
Yeah.
This is something that maybe didn't exist 30 years ago, even not so much 20, 25 years ago.
I can tell this is going to get controversial. I can tell.
It's this concept that we should, I always say something a little bit controversial. It's this concept that we should be doing things that are based on evidence, so
yeah.
on studies and research evidence. It's often misunderstood by many people, and I am known, you know, in my group of, you know, peers and teaching, whenever I teach a course, and you know, you may know this, that I'm known as evidence. So I'm the guy, if you have a question on the evidence, some of the other, like my colleagues say, go ask Erdem. He'll answer the question. He's the evidence-based guy. And I am all for evidence-informed, evidence-based practice. I use the word evidence-informed.
Yes,
so
I like that.
That more reflects what we usually do. But I would say that the risk of this push towards evidence-based medicine is, in the past, you know, we tend to swing the pendulum too far to one end, and that's a misunderstanding of evidence-based medicine. There was a time when, you know, there were these gurus
yes.
who had, especially in physiotherapy and other related, you know, physical medicine type of professions, who were great innovators. They had lots of new ideas, but they were, you know, we'll say, you know, it was whatever they said went. If they had
right.
an idea, they taught it, they developed entire, you know, courses on these ideas, and people just followed them like it was, you know, like it was the gospel.
Yes.
And then evidence-based medicine comes along, and what happens is that it's very hard to do that. It's very hard just to say that this is the way it is. You just listen to me, trust me, I am correct. So then we get a lot of naysayers. We get this, you know, this negative attitude that whenever somebody comes up with something new or innovative, people say, well, that's not evidence-based.
Mm-hmm.
That, or is that evidence-based? Do you have any evidence for that? So the threat of this kind of misunderstanding of evidence-based medicine is that we can lose the innovators.
Yeah.
We can lose innovation in healthcare.
Yeah.
So that's why it's really important to link the clinical and research field, because the real
yeah.
spirit of evidence-based medicine is that we study what we're doing.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
It's basically, what are we doing and studying? It's not meant to crush innovation and new thought and thought leadership.
Yeah.
It's meant to take it and develop it
yes.
and really focus where things should be focused
yeah.
and give up on the things that aren't going to work.
Exactly. Yeah, I couldn't agree more.
One little interjection there.
No, that's a good interjection. And the idea is not to you know, tear down the innovators at all. Like an innovator can certainly develop a new technique, a new way of looking at a problem, and then you know, someone who has a reasonable level of emotional maturity can then evaluate through the scientific process, which has a huge amount of value, what it is that they're doing. And you know what, if the results come back and things are not as promising as we might have hoped, then a true innovator can say, okay, that's cool, let's go out and try something new. Let's go out and try something different. And that's the way that it should be. I really like that idea of being evidence-informed rather than evidence-based, so I'm completely on board with you. There is a difference between the two. And yeah, so excellent answer. Good introduction.
We're just not at the stage where, you know, I think, and I'm not saying the goal should be evidence-based medicine. Yeah. I just, in many areas, we're not at the place yet where we can always say, yeah, I am evidence-based in everything we do. Because sometimes in many areas, there's just no evidence. There's just no study in a particular area or a particular type of injury. So in that sense, you know, we have to use a little bit of our own experience. But if you actually look at the most common definitions of evidence-based medicine, it's not just looking at the scientific proof for or against something. It incorporates something else, two other things, which is the second thing is the clinician's own experience, and of course the values and choices of the patient. So that's important with something like dry needling, especially if I have evidence that in a very specific area that dry needling is going to work for somebody, I can't say to somebody, you should have this treatment because it's been shown to work. If they say, you know, when I mention a needle, if their pupils dilate and they start sweating and they don't want to have anything to do with the needle, which happens to many people, then I need to be able to do something else and develop a different plan to work together with that person. So we have to remember the true spirit of evidence-based medicine when we try to apply it.
Yep, and that's the art of being a good clinician. On this topic of dry needling, there's a lot of different ways. So you did your research in the effects of dry needling on maximal voluntary contraction. You dry needle someone, do they get a stronger muscular contraction after that intervention? But the way that we see it used clinically commonly is to treat muscle dysfunction and painful trigger points, which, as we discussed, are these local areas of contracted fibers with nodules at the middle. They're painful. That's what we see being treated in clinic. There's a lot of different approaches that are out there for using dry needling to treat that type of a problem, ranging from the gun needling techniques, the Gokavi transverse technique, integrated dry needling, and even some of the stuff that's coming out of the medical acupuncture world. Are these different techniques, is it important to recognize the difference between these techniques, or are these differences without a distinction when it comes to the outcomes?
Well, when it comes to the outcomes, we're really in the early stages, you know, the very early dark ages of researching dry needling, and perhaps, you know, more broadly, things like medical acupuncture as well. So I would not say that there's any evidence that compares at this point one approach, we'll say, to dry needling, or one theory of dry needling to another at this point. So I don't think it would be safe for anybody to say that, oh, you know, the way I do it is better than the way anybody else does it. But I would say that with dry needling in particular, the differences between a lot, there are going to be some technique differences, you know, hold the needle this way, insert it into the muscle this way. But for the most part, if you were just a layperson and you didn't know any of the theory and you just watched somebody dry needling, it's going to look very, very similar. And the differences between different schools of thought are mainly in the theory and the, we'll say, the explanation of how things are working. But most people will practice quite similarly, whether they're taking a gun approach or the Gokavi approach. For the most part, there'll be sometimes, you know, a little bit of difference, but for the most part, people are treating very similar areas of the body. So I would say that there's no one path, you know.
Right. And it might go back to what you had mentioned previously where, hey, let's look at the person that we have in front of us, understand who they are, where they're coming from, what the problem is. And some people are going to respond to a particular technique better, and others are going to respond to another technique better, and some people aren't going to respond at all. So maybe that's the sort of way for us to
look
at it.
That's the way I practice in the sense that I was trained originally in the gun approach, which is a specific approach that has theories that, you know, the muscle trigger points aren't really the issue. They're just a sign that there's a bigger issue involved that involves the nerves. Mm-hmm. And then there are other approaches like the Gokavi technique that looks more at kind of the role of trigger points and how the pain refers and affects other muscles and how different causes, biomechanical causes on how you use muscles can influence the opposing muscle groups. But there's so much overlap, and I will vary the way I, you know, which approach maybe I lean towards based on, like you said, the person that I'm working with. If they have more of this, you know, indication that there's involvement in the spine or a pattern that tells me there's something going on more with the nerves, I might take more of a gun approach. But right. I really am a big proponent of one of the courses I teach is called integrated dry needling.
Right.
That, you know, we really have to integrate this technique into the broader context of what we do, which should always include education and some sort of movement and exercise.
Totally.
And we should also be open to integrating all the different theories that led to dry needling being a practice, because they all have merits. They all have made major contributions to at least what I do and what I teach as well.
Yeah. And that dovetails beautifully into my, or transitions beautifully into my next question, which is, so there's some folks out there, schools of thought, suggesting that, you know what, we shouldn't look at this type of a technique, a dry needling technique, to be used in concert with other typical physical therapy interventions like, hey, exercise training, which is the bread and butter of what I do. Do you, and what I'm hearing from you is that, yes, you do indeed look at it as part of a multimodal approach, so dry needling and other stuff as appropriate to the patient.
Yes, yeah. So yeah. I would say you should never have rules that use the word never, you know, or always. So when I look at it, and sometimes the different schools of thought are sometimes a little bit varied, because sometimes the types of patients that people are seeing, you know, what we would call the patient population are different. So in cases where somebody is really, really sensitive, somebody has persistent, you know, long durations of pain, and often these people have already tried exercise. They've already tried, you know, they've had manual therapies, manipulations, you know, different medications, often surgeries. In those cases, it's often dry needling can be, I would say, a powerful intervention in the fact that it's a lot of stimulus into your body. It's a lot of stimulation. So in those cases, sometimes it's wiser just to start with not doing too much, just to start with dry needling, just to test their response and see where it is. But in the population that I see, you know, I call it the population, but the people that I work with tend to be often higher, you know, what we would say higher functioning, you know, that's clinician speak, but their people are pretty active.
Yeah.
They're often athletes.
Yeah.
They're often people that in the course of a day do, you know, pretty intensive training. These are people that it's very hard to say, I want you to stop all exercise. I don't want you to go for that massage that you've been going to twice a week as part of your high performance training for the last 10 years of your triathlon career, whether they're just recreational or not. So I try and integrate it into their treatment. I may modify certain things, but in terms of the research out there, there's not a lot that looks at whether this is something that we should do alone or combine with other things like massage or stretching. Yeah, just to summarize, to make a long story short, never say never and never say always. That there's a time and a place to combine this with other interventions, and there's a time where you might just want to do it in isolation or not do it at all as well, even in a patient that you might choose to do it as you progress through treatment, and that's based on something that we call sensitivity, or how sensitive somebody is to different types of stimulus.
I think that as well, there's an important nugget there for clients and for patients, because it really is a team effort in physiotherapy. It's unlike some other type of healthcare disciplines where, you know, you can get a magic blue pill and things get better. I mean, it really does require the intervention of the patient as well as the intervention of the clinician in physiotherapy. So I always encourage clients to talk about what works for them and what doesn't work for them. And hey, like if I sent you home with exercises or something to practice, like what were you really into doing? And what were you like, nah, I don't really like that. Even if it's just because, you know what, I wasn't into that exercise. Because that helps me to craft a better intervention. So like really making it a team effort and talking about what works for you and what doesn't work, I think is really important. And clients should never be afraid to have that discussion and think about those types of things.
Absolutely. You know, I always say that my job and our job as in healthcare is to help people help themselves.
Yeah.
And really, we just kind of get momentum going, or help people get momentum going, and they speed it up.
Yeah, I really look at myself as a coach rather than someone who's going to wave a magic wand and make something better. All I can do is show you the simple things that you can do consistently to help drive things in the right direction. There ain't no rocket science, right? And what we do.
We tend to overcomplicate things.
We really do. Totally agree. Yeah. Let's keep it simple. Maybe that's just, we do that to make ourselves feel better. I don't know. Like, oh, look how complicated I am. Right.
Yes. But it's not. I know so much.
Yes.
Don't you see the letters?
Yeah. I have value. Yeah. Degrees, diplomas, etc. So turning that corner from that little tidbit to this other idea that I'm going to go in the opposite direction now, and you have done things. You've done things to differentiate yourself as a clinician and to add some unique value to the world with what it is that you do, and to the world of physiotherapy, and to your clients in very specifically. That's awesome. What can therapists and any professional, anyone, but therapists in particular, what can they be doing to differentiate themselves on an individual and even on a general level? Like, what can we be doing?
So, I mean, I would say one thing that I've always, lived my professional life by and life in general is that always strive for excellence. You know, whatever you do, if you're not going to do it as well as you can to the best of your ability and capability, then consider why you're doing it in the first place. Yeah. And when it comes to healthcare, this is especially important because this is a job where, like any job of service to other people, people are coming to us. You know, they're investing their time, their money, sometimes their belief in us and our experience and our education. So we really owe it to, I always say when I show up at work at my clinic every day that I always need to bring my A game, my best self, because people expect that from you, and we owe it to them. So always strive for excellence. And I think that the way that in physiotherapy or any healthcare profession, the way that we should do that is, many physiotherapists walk around saying, oh, there's experts in this area and I'm not one of them. Mm-hmm. Or, I'm just a regular physiotherapist. And I see this because I see this in students. There is this mindset in many people, and in others there is. And I say that there is no reason why we can't strive to be an expert in something or in one area that we're passionate about.
Yes.
If anybody else can become an expert, then you can become an expert.
Oh, so my goodness. That is an A-plus answer. Yeah, keep going.
Yeah, if you strive for that, if you strive to be the expert in your particular field or area of interest, whether it's broadly in orthopedic physiotherapy or whether it's in a very specific area of physiotherapy or a specific type of injury like running injuries or certain sports injuries, dance medicine, female, pelvic health, different chronic pain, whatever it may be that you're passionate about, you should try and find your passions.
Yeah.
Roll with them and then try and be an expert. And the other thing I would say is that, if you ever feel like you are the expert, then you haven't done enough.
Yeah.
Because, no real expert ever feels like they are the expert and they know everything. They always think that there's so much more that they don't know and so much more. And I have felt like that all the time.
Yep.
Early on, in your career, you say, well, I'm going to take this course. And I'm gonna know so much, and I'm just gonna get everybody better all the time as quickly as possible. And then you realize sometimes the more you learn, the more you know you don't know. But sometimes the more you learn, you realize that it's not just about knowledge and just information, whether that information is useful or not, but it's how you apply it in your relationship with the patient, how you communicate.
Yeah,
this is the other point of it is. We really need to differentiate ourselves not through things like, well, I have this degree or
there's nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with that. No, that's part of the package.
Yeah.
But what I think really makes us, stand out and liked by patients in any healthcare professionals world is the ability to understand the needs
yes.
of that particular person,
yeah.
why they're coming to you,
yeah.
understand their goals,
yeah.
and then see how you fit into that
yes.
and be able to provide solutions yeah. to their problems and motivate them.
Yeah.
And that's really what we do. That goes back to what you were saying about we really are coaches.
Yes.
We're not healers. Yeah. We're coaches.
Yeah. And the ability to understand what it is that your patient's goals are and then excited about those goals
right.
and to be sincere about that, not to be, you know, this is not some fake thing. This is, you know, and this goes to loving what you do. If you really love what you do, you're going to be good at it because
right.
you're going to care and you're going to do the work to get awesome. And that is infectious. And then you can transfer that into empathizing with your client's goals and really getting on board with them. And when you're excited about their goals, they get to feel that. They also get to feel excited about their goals. And that
right.
is such a gift to be able to give someone. I think that another thing to touch on what you were talking about, hey, you know what? Setting a vision for yourself that you can be awesome, that you can achieve excellence. And this is something that we should all strive for. I think this idea of setting a self-image of that's just the kind of person that you are is foundationally important, not just for us as clinicians, but for every human being. We have to genuinely look at ourselves as the type of people who just achieve excellence, who are excellent. That doesn't mean that it just happens.
Right.
It doesn't mean that it just comes down from on high. But if you look at yourself and you know, write down on a piece of paper, I'm the kind of guy who, let's say in your case, it does the research to contribute to a new area of clinical science. I'm just that kind of guy. That's who I am. I create excellence in that area. It's going to happen because you're going to be more in a state of mind where you're able to do the little things each and every day that move you towards that goal. So I think this idea of vision setting and self-image are hugely important for all of us. I wish that there were courses like this in school. Why are we not learning this in school?
Yeah, well, I mean, it is a good question. I think we, you know, going back to what I said with, you know, the degree and the
yeah.
certifications, those are all important. Those
yeah.
are what I call the foundation.
Yeah.
You know, you need that and you should look for that in your practitioners. You know, it would be, you know, not a good situation if anybody could just hang a sign saying, you know, open for healthcare business and
right.
you just went to the first place that you saw. You know, we have to have baseline. And all the study that we do is really the baseline. But then you have to build, stack onto that with experience and passion and motivation.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are fields of study in performance and human psychology. And I, for one, think that there should be more of that. There
yeah.
is a little bit in school. You know, there's these courses on professionalism and communication
yeah.
skills. But there could always be more in an ideal
yeah.
world and really
oh.
to instill the confidence
yeah.
and passion in
yeah.
healthcare practitioners.
Yeah, I think there's huge opportunities for that in education. I don't know. I mean, I'd be curious to talk to people who are involved in educating about what their thoughts are on that. But I really think that is sort of, it should be fundamental practice. And that also is something that we can give to our clients again, because in the same way that we can think of ourselves as the type of people who can achieve excellence, so too should our patients think that. So my patient walks in,
absolutely.
You're the kind of person who just does athletic things. That's who you are. Congratulations. You've brought yourself in. That means you're the type of person who cares about taking care of yourself, who cares about improving your physical health and your physical capacity. You know who else is that? Athletes. So you're behaving like an athlete. And that's a theme that I touch on a lot in my
right.
clinical practice. I think I love that type of idea. I love that you know, you're touching on that. I couldn't be more on the same page. So yeah, thanks for, you know, affirming me. Okay. All right. So that was a good answer. So that's what we can all be doing to differentiate ourselves. In general, as a patient, how do you choose a good clinician? If you're a patient, you're out there looking for someone, like what should you be doing to look for a good clinician, let alone a good physiotherapist?
Well, I think, yeah. So, I mean, when I look for somebody, the first thing that I honestly do myself
mm-hmm.
is I will ask, always try to find if you can, if you are able to know somebody, you know, if you've been living somewhere long enough and if you know enough people in your network, to ask somebody who has personally experienced that practitioner's treatment, So yeah. The interactions with them, that's always very, very important to say, well, how was your experience with them? You know, how was your relationship with them? And it's not always about, well, did you get better and how fast did you get better? Because satisfaction in healthcare isn't always about just that. That's a big part of it, but that's definitely a big part of it. You obviously want to do a full, what I would call, background check in their credentials. You know, I'm somebody who maybe more than others will do things like a lot of research on a specific area, whether it's I'm going to have my car fixed, maybe to the point of obsession, or I'm going to, you know, find a new accountant or something like that. You know, I do things like research. Well, they have these letters behind their name. Well, what do these letters actually mean? Because these days people throw all kinds of letters behind their names without meaning. Sometimes they're meaningful, sometimes they're not. So I would say when you see all those letters, actually look them up. See what they're about. You can find anything that indicates that those are of value or not, because especially in our profession, there's a lot of certifications out there. There are a lot of postgraduate types of studies. Some of them are more common than others, but there are others that are well-known, you know, are international in their scope or accredited internationally. So that's always something to look for, but that's not enough. Just, you know, just having the letters behind your name is never enough. I would always encourage people to also ask about, you know, personal experiences of others. If you don't have that, you know, this whole concept of going online and looking at reviews, you know, it's hit or miss. I think there's a bias of people who have maybe had bad experiences or really great experiences to do that. I think there's, in some cases, I'm not going to call it review rigging, but you know, individual testimonials of strangers that you can't actually talk to and ask about the validity of this review. It's something to be considered, but in the absence of it, that's one area to do is to go online.
I think it's something to look at, but to be taken with a grain of salt. But it's certainly some value there.
Absolutely. And the most important thing I would look for, that I personally look for, is if you can look for some sort of indication that the person is passionate about what they do. And you might look at that through some sort of evidence that from the time that they graduated, that they continue to be passionate through learning. But even more importantly, that perhaps, and maybe this is my own bias because I also teach, but that they're somehow involved in teaching. Now, I don't mean they have to be, you know, a university professor, but perhaps they do something like mentor others. You know, that they have indicated that I am also involved in taking, you know, entry level or university students or postgraduate students studying to a certain pathway. That they, you know, perhaps volunteer their time towards certain certain types of committees, showing that they're really involved, that they're motivated. And I think that's a big thing. So asking your friends and peers, coworkers, looking at their background, and most importantly, some sort of indication that they really are passionate about what they do. Like if I were to look for a physiotherapist in downtown Toronto and I came across your video blogs, I would think that that's somebody who clearly is very passionate about what they're doing. They're not just showing up at the door, oh, you know, 9 o'clock, treat some patients, go home, 5 o'clock. They haven't lost the passion for what they do because they're actually, you're taking time, for example, to speak with me. I learn as much from you as you learn from me. And it
shows. I don't
shows
know that that's necessarily true, but thank you.
It shows that, you know, you are definitely very passionate about what you do. And I think those types of indicators are key.
That's good. I agree. And all those things you talked about, like people who are, you know, they are doing the credentialing, they demonstrate that they want to give value to other people in their field as well as their clients, and they show a genuine interest in what it is. That those are all indicators that this is an individual who cares about giving value to the world. And that's something that counts in the professional world, counts in the social world, counts everything that you do. So yeah, that's great. I appreciate that answer. That's good. All right, so let's say that someone wants to follow up with you, Erdem. How can they learn more about you? Like, where can they find out more about your services? How would you direct us to reach out to you if we have further questions?
Well, the easiest way is just to, I guess, land on my website. I will give you the address. It's www.yorkphysio.ca. That's yorkphysio.ca. Okay. And you could just go there. You can find a little bit more about the clinic, where it's located. Most importantly, if you have any other questions, there's links to our phone number, email, all that kind of different ways to get in touch with us.
Yeah.
And sometimes you just want to ask some questions and see if you know, you could benefit from what I do or what my colleagues at the clinic also do. I like to say it's a team approach. So, you know, I like to build a team of like-minded, motivated physiotherapists around me. So just getting in touch through the website and giving us a call.
That's awesome. Thank you. And you're up in Richmond Hill, which is just north of Toronto here in Ontario, Canada.
That's right.
Yep. And is there anything else and we'll put that information about your clinic and how people can reach you in the notes for the video as well. So I would encourage people to reach out to you. And is there anything else that you'd like to leave us with? Any final thoughts or comments that you'd like to leave the viewers with?
I would just say that, you know, it doesn't matter what level of, you know, performance you're at or how bad or how minor your pain is, how unrealistic your goals may be and what you can achieve, or what other people have told you before, you know, like, oh, your x-ray is really bad, or
right.
Oh, you have this. No, it's got a name that has a lot of syllables. I think that it in terms of, you know, pain and movement, these things are so complex. If you focus on how you function and how you feel, that you can always make some level of improvement. And by working with somebody who is really, you know, going to be your coach, you know, your physiotherapist or your healthcare practitioner, whoever you choose, that person is really there to help you set goals that are realistic and hopefully attainable.
Yeah.
And you can always improve your physical health.
Yes.
No matter how good or how bad you may perceive it to be. My best advice.
That very good advice it is. That's awesome. Thank you very much, Dr. Erdem Huner, for speaking with us today. Really appreciate you taking the time on a Sunday afternoon, speaking about being passionate about what you do. Thanks for taking the time to talk to me today. And I certainly look forward to interacting with you again in the future. When you follow up with those next sets of research projects, we'll get back on the blog again and we'll do another interview, hopefully if you'd agree to speak with us again in the future.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me and I really enjoyed it.
Thank you. Okay, bye now.
Okay, bye.